God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Grace of Van. We're really glad the Lord brought you here today. And online worshipers, many of you we know by name, and we're glad that you're here too. Hey, you guys came on a holiday weekend, right, with a lot of fall break travel and stuff. You guys want to know a Grace of Van secret? It's a Grace of Van secret. You don't know this, but on the pulpit right here is a brass plaque. It's been here since 2002. It's a quote from John 12:21, where these Greeks come and they say, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." And so every time somebody's up here preaching, they're looking out at the room and they see that, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." That's what we're here for, ladies and gentlemen. That's what you're about to sing. That's what the name of this church is all about, is presenting Jesus as this Savior. Let us pray. Righteous Father, we bow before you in the name of Jesus, remembering it is only by the means that you provided, who is Christ, that we can approach you with freedom and confidence. And so we do, Lord, remembering that you are good and gracious, that you know everything about us, that you have this world in your hands, in your care, in your purview, and you regard us as precious in the name of your Son. So bind us up, Lord. Make our hearts happy. We pray it for Christ's glory. Amen. Will you stand? Worship with us.
I will glory in my Redeemer, whose priceless blood has ransomed me. Mine was the sin that drove the bitterness and hung him on that judgment tree. I will glory in my Redeemer, who crushed the power of sin and death. My only Savior before the holy judge, the Lamb.
Good morning, Grace Savannah. We're so glad to have you worshiping with us today. Please have a seat. I am Kim Killebrew and the Director of Women's Ministry here. I have a few announcements that I want to draw your attention to, so hang with me. The first one I have, was I supposed to tell about connecting? Probably. If you are visiting with us today, we want to know about you. We want to know that you're here with us. There should be a QR code in the bulletin that you can use your phones and connect with us. We want to know more about you and how we can help you get to know Grace Savannah. The next announcement I have for you is 40 Days for Life. If you have a desire to stand with our Life MIT against abortion, we have an opportunity for you to do that. There's more information in the bulletin, but you can protest in front of the Planned Parenthood of Memphis with our Life MIT, so you're welcome to get involved with that. We'd love to have you. Next week, we have a new members class. If you have been coming to Grace Savannah for maybe just today or maybe for a while and you want to know more about us, this is the place to do that. So we have a class next Sunday after church. You can stay and have lunch with us. We'd love to have you. Just register according to the directions in the bulletin. The next one is an intergenerational event we have for our senior adults and our senior high students. I think there's barbecue and games and trivia, but we love to do intergenerational events here. We are a family of God, and we want our people to connect with one another of all ages. And so this is a great opportunity, whether you're a senior adult or you are a senior high student, maybe you have a senior high student, encourage them to get involved in that. Next, we have Trunk or Treat, and this is such a fun event. It's huge. This year, it's on October 28th. It's a Saturday evening. We decorate cars, and we open our trunks and hand out candy. If you have children or grandchildren, you won't want to miss this. Bring them, come, walk around, get a hot dog or a hamburger. It really is a blast. I love taking part in this. I usually get to decorate a trunk, and it is just so much fun. So I hope you'll be there for that. And finally is an event that I get to be a part of, and this year we are supporting A Way Out, which is a ministry that helps encourage women to leave the sexual exploitation industry in any way. So they are providing opportunities for women to get a fresh start in their lives, and they have residents that live in the ministry at A Way Out, and we are doing a blessing shower for them. So our Grace Venture, which is an arm of our mission team, has provided all of the funds for us to purchase gifts for these women that they have never had before. Some of it is just a new dress or boots, things that they desire. They actually have someone that's about to graduate and needs items for her home. Well, we're going to shower those women with these precious gifts that they've chosen, and we want you to come be a part of that. So come celebrate with these women, get to know them, and tell them that we are supporting them in the name of Jesus Christ. I hope you'll get involved with that. That's all I have for you. So if you'll stand up and greet those around you, that'd be great.
We'll be right back. With me. O high King of heaven, we do approach your throne with confidence. Confidence because we know the victory has been won. We praise you that in your infinite wisdom, your infinite mercy, your infinite love, your infinite grace, that you sent your Son. Jesus, we thank you for your perfect life. We thank you for your death in our place. We praise you for the resurrection. We are confident that you are seated at the Father's right hand, even interceding for us right now. And because all that's true, Jesus, because of your work, we draw near with boldness, knowing that there is no condemnation, not even a hint of condemnation for those who are in Christ. Father, we come to you and we also confess our sin. We come to you with our sin because there's nowhere else to go. There's no one else who can do anything about it. You've told us that if we confess our sins, not only will you forgive our sins, but you will also cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Well, we come in here with a different variety of sins, but we all come looking to the same source, your Son. And even now, as we confess our sins, would you confirm? And would you give us a fresh cleansing from our sin? Father, many walk in here, and they're struggling, they're hurting. And as much as we would want, and we do ask, that the circumstances in their life would change, you would bring healing, you would bring restored relationships where they have been fractured. But even more than that, we ask that your presence would be very, very evidently with us and with those who are struggling, that you're with them, and would you help us to believe that you're actually for us and not against us. Father, our world seems to be falling apart. It's coming apart by the seams every minute. It seems like it's unraveling more and more. And would you give us more trust that your kingdom will not be toppled over, your kingdom will not be conquered. As a matter of fact, that your kingdom will go forth in the darkness and because of the darkness. In the middle of all these wars, Father, would you bring salvation? Would you bring salvation to the Muslim? Would you bring salvation to the Jew? Would they be reconciled to you? Would they be reconciled to each other? We know that the gospel is the only hope. Father, you have given us a lot, and we are glad to be able to give some of it back to you. Would you use our giving in a way that would be pleasing to you? Would every cent be used for kingdom expansion? We ask for this in your Son's name. Amen.
sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul.
If you have your Bibles, be turning to the book of Zechariah, which is near the end of the Old Testament, the book of Zechariah, chapter 3, and as you do, Dr. Young is, by the way, out of town, and so my name's Kyle Jacobson, I'm filling in this morning, but I wanted to remind you that October is Blue Card Month. You should be very familiar with these by now if you've been attending or been a member for Grace of Ann for any period of time. In October, we take these blue cards, and you have to have a blue card. You can find them at the info desk, and you take one, read through it, it'll give you the qualifications of elder. And you are now in charge of nominating men that you think are qualified for the office of elder. So if you have not done that yet, it's a really important job that we have as members of Grace of Ann. So make sure you get on that as soon as possible. October 31st is the deadline, so please, but don't wait till the last minute, it'd be helpful. Zechariah chapter 3, Dr. Young has been doing a series called Great Chapters for a while now. Well, Zechariah 3 is a great, great chapter. And we're only going to read the first five verses this morning. This is God's word. Then he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked from the fire?" Now Joshua was standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments. And the angel said to those who were standing before him, "Remove the filthy garments from him." And to him he said, "Behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you, and I will clothe you with pure vestments." And I said, "Let them put a clean turban on his head." So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him with garments. And the angel of the Lord was standing by. This is God's word. I'm not one that really remembers my dreams. I'm not even sure if I have dreams most of the time. But there is one dream that I've had a couple times in my life that has stuck with me because it's just incredibly unsettling. And so it's hard to forget. I'm going to an important event with a bunch of people that I really am desiring to impress. And for some reason, when I walk into the main room in front of everyone, for some reason I'm missing an article of clothing. Or clothing altogether. And what I've found is that is, for some reason, not that uncommon of a dream. As a matter of fact, the so-called experts on the internet who want to give us like psychology behind these dreams, they all have this consensus that the reason why we have those dreams, it reveals some sort of insecurity within us. Some sort of fear that we are not going to be accepted or acceptable to those we really want acceptance from. You know, there is, I think, a pretty good correlation between clothing and being covered and acceptance and being acceptable to others. You know, I mean, how much of our day, how much of our lives do we spend wondering what should we wear? asking people, what should we wear? I mean, church websites a lot of times have on there what to wear when you show up. And especially before those really big events, when you know there's a group of people that, again, you're a little bit insecure, you really want them to like you, you really want to have their acceptance, and so you go to your closet full of clothes, and you look at your closet, and you think, I've got nothing to wear. Because there's a correlation between clothing and acceptance. And even if you come in here saying, I don't care about my clothes, I haven't shopped for clothes in years. Every one of us come in here with a deep desire. There's a universal desire that we would be accepted and acceptable. Even if you tell yourself, I don't care what others think, that's simply not true. There's someone and somewhere out there that I want their acceptance and I want to be seen as acceptable. In this vision that we just read from Zechariah's vision, this has to be the most horrifying moment ever of being underdressed. Because the man in this vision, he's not just underdressed for a social gathering or a wedding reception or a church event. He finds himself woefully underdressed as he's on trial in the heavenly courts. And to be found unacceptable while you're on trial in the heavenly courts, that has eternal consequences. And so what we need to know is the dilemma that we see in this vision of this man. This is our dilemma. This is our problem as well. There's three points I have this morning. The first is I want to talk about the problem with gaining acceptance in the heavenly courts. There's a major problem. But then we're going to move to the grounds by which we are acceptable and accepted in the heavenly courts. And then from there we'll go to the application of being accepted in the heavenly courts. So there you go, the problem, the grounds, and the acceptance, or the application of being accepted in the heavenly courts. But before I get to any of that, I need to take a moment just to give us a little bit of quick context when it comes to the book of Zechariah. Because if somebody was to walk up to you today and say, hey, which book of the Bible should I read? I would doubt that Zechariah makes the top 40 or 50. I mean, it's not a book that we are too familiar with, and honestly, it's not an easy book to read. A lot of dreams, a lot of visions, a lot of symbols. It's not an easy book to get through. But what we need to know is that Zechariah comes on the scene and he's there to minister to a group of people that have come out of the Babylonian captivity. They were, you remember, the people of God were swept into captivity into Babylon. Jerusalem, the temple, their homes, everything was destroyed. And then after 70 years in Babylon, a small remnant gets to go home to Jerusalem. And to this little remnant that's now in Jerusalem, we need to know that this is probably maybe the darkest time in the history of Israel. Long gone are the glory days of David and Solomon. Long gone are those days. This group of people, they're struggling in every way possible. They're struggling politically as they're still under the thumb of a foreign government. There's no Davidic king. They're struggling economically. They're poor. And more than that, they're also struggling spiritually. And the reason why we know they're struggling spiritually is because when they go back to Jerusalem, they start to rebuild the temple, but then for some reason, they stop. Work ceases on the temple for 16 years. And that dilapidated temple is a monument. It's a picture of the spiritual apathy that's set in with this group of people. Or at least their misplaced priorities, that the worship of God is very secondary, at best, as they're doing other things. And not only that, but this group of people, they are continually and constantly reminded of the sins and the stains of the past. As they're walking around in these heaps of ruins, they're reminded of their forefathers' sin and their sin, which caused this mess to come on them in the first place. And so they probably are just discouraged, wondering, as they look around them, have we forever forfeited the promises of God? Have we been forever rejected by God? Have we lost the status of being his people? Are we forever banished to exile? And into that situation, Zechariah is raised up. And as we see here, one of the key figures during this time was the high priest. The high priest whose name is Joshua. And Joshua is front and center in this vision in chapter 3. And if you're going to understand chapter 3 at all, you have to recognize this is not just a trial of a man, even though he himself is on trial. But Zechariah, as the high priest, he represents everyone. He represents Israel. He represents the people of God. And so what becomes of Zechariah in this trial? If he is rebuked, if he is condemned, if he is cast off, then all of Israel is rebuked, condemned, and cast off. You can see why the original reader would be very, very interested in this trial. It speaks to their circumstances. But this is not just Old Testament issues. This is us. This is our issue. And so with that said, let's move to the problem. The problem of gaining acceptance in the heavenly courts. Look again at verse 1. In Zechariah chapter 3, it says, "Then he showed me Joshua the high priest." We just talked about him. "Standing before," now that key word, "standing before," that's trial language. "Standing before the angel of the Lord." Now we have to pause and ask the question, who is the angel of the Lord? Now we have to remember that when it comes to judgment in this way, heavenly judgment, this kind of judgment, only God can judge. Only God can be on the throne and judge like this. And knowing that, another thing when we think about the angel of the Lord, you notice in verse 2, it rotates. It goes from the angel of the Lord, and then it says, "And the Lord," in all caps, "Yahweh," said to Satan. And then in verse 3, it rotates back to the angel of the Lord. So between the fact that this angel of the Lord, he's judging, and by the way, remember in John 5, judgment has been given over to who? The Son of God. The fact that the Son of God is the one who judges, and not only that, but there's this rotation between the angel of the Lord and Yahweh. Well, who is the judge in this trial? It's Jesus before he took on flesh. Jesus before the incarnation. It's the pre-incarnate Christ. And you notice here, so the pre-incarnate Christ is the judge. But notice who the prosecuting attorney is. Because this is such a massive trial, hell has put forth their ace attorney. It says, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan, whose name, by the way, means adversary or accuser. And the adversary, the accuser, Satan, standing at his right hand to accuse him. You know, when we think about Satan's work, you know, we know that Satan is a deceiver. We see that in the Garden of Eden. We know that Satan is a tempter. We see that in the wilderness when he tempted Christ. We know that he's a roaring lion looking to devour. We know he's a murderer. We know that he's a persecutor of the church. We see that in the seven letters to the church in Revelation. But his most insidious, his most stealthy work is done in the form of accusation. Why is it that we can forget so much, but for some reason, our deep, dark sins are recalled with such freshness and vividness? Why is that? Why am I simply going about my day and all of a sudden I'm bombarded with the embarrassment of my past, and I find myself almost cursing myself because I'm embarrassed all over again? Oh, it's a very potent weapon. It's a stealthy weapon. It's a sneaky weapon. It's one that goes pretty much undetected many times. But it's such a potent weapon because what accusation does is it hinders, it minimizes the Christian ministry, the minister of the Christian. It minimizes his joy in Christ. When I am overwhelmed by accusation, my ministry is minimized, my joy is minimized. It is a very potent weapon. But here in this chapter, I want you to see that the case of the prosecution is an airtight case. At least it seems like it's an airtight case. And the reason why it's an airtight case is found in verse 3. Now Joshua was standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments. When you see that word, filthy garments, I mean, you have to understand how filthy we're talking about. That word is closely connected with human waste, human feces, human excrement. It's as if he's standing there, and what Joshua did was he grabbed these clothes out of a sewer line and put them on. He is utterly vile. And to fully grasp how much of a scandal this is, you have to understand that there's a lot of words, a lot of ink dedicated to what the priest was supposed to wear. Exodus chapter 28 gives us, it's a whole chapter telling us in great detail, this is what the priest is supposed to wear. He's supposed to wear clean, holy, bright garments. Why? Because it's a reminder to the people that as he ministers before the Lord, that he is ministering before a holy God who cannot have defilement, who cannot have sin in his presence. So what the priest wore mattered. Not only that, but probably the biggest day of the year for the high priest was the Day of Atonement. Remember that day when he would go back behind the curtain into the Holy of Holies, into the very presence of God to offer sacrifices for both himself and the people? And Leviticus chapter 16 is very clear on what the high priest is supposed to do so that he doesn't die. Because to go into the presence of God, not with the appropriate attire, means you die. And so in Leviticus chapter 16, verse 4, it says this. God says to the high priest, he shall put on the holy linen coat, and he shall have the linen undergarments on his body, and he shall tie the linen sash around his waist and wear the linen turban. These are the holy garments. He shall bathe his body in water and put them on. And so can you imagine how deeply troubled Zechariah would be as he sees his high priest who represents him standing before the Holy One on the day of judgment on the trial, and he's clothed in the most filthiest garments imaginable. The most vilest substance is caked on his garments. Can you imagine how troubling that would be? And as for Satan, he doesn't even need words. His whole case can simply be, do you see this? That is completely unacceptable. All he's got to do is point. And Joshua has no words to say. Those who have boldness and arrogance to say, oh, well, if there is a God and I will, and if there is a final judgment, I'm sure I could talk it out with him. There is no words. Because he's wearing the condemning evidence. But we have to make a very important point here. That these filthy garments are not there because of some sort of outside factor. It's not as if Joshua tripped and fell into some sort of pile of waste and is like, whoops, well, what can I do? Because you notice in verse 4, when the angel said, remove the filthy garments from him, and then he says, behold, I've taken your iniquity away from you. These filthy garments are a representation of his sinful condition. And by the way, y'all, this is the great equalizer. No matter where we were born, no matter our race, no matter how much money we have, no matter whether we are a moral person or an immoral person, we come before the throne stained. This is how we approach the throne. This is how we are clothed. Joshua is probably a moral man, and he represents moral people. He also represents some pretty immoral people. But there we all are, stained with filthy garments. Because there's no one righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. This is the great equalizer. This is a picture of standing before the heavenly courts, left to ourselves. It looks like a slam dunk case as Joshua bears and wears the condemning evidence. Let's move now to the grounds by which we are accepted in the heavenly courts. What is amazing about this text to me is when we get to verse 2, if you've never read this before, what you would expect is the angel of the Lord to look at Joshua and rebuke and condemn him. But instead, the rebuke and the condemnation does not fall on Joshua. It falls on the prosecuting attorney. Verse 2. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you." When you see that word rebuke, you have to understand this is not just a word of disapproval or that God, the angel of the Lord, is just disappointed with Satan, or this is just a mild slap on the wrist, a mild scolding. No, remember in Psalm 106 that God rebukes the Red Sea and it becomes dry. Remember, it's in Mark 4, in the raging, tempestuous storm that Jesus stands up on the boat and rebukes the storm, and it is immediately quieted. And so when the angel of the Lord rebukes Satan, this is laced with divine power. This is a powerful, shut your mouth, hush your face. You're found out of order. Is that justice? Why does the rebuke fall on Satan? I believe it's because he did not handle the evidence rightly. He did not present all the evidence. He hid. He's guilty of hiding evidence, which is what he does as an accuser. So some of the key evidence in our grounds for being acceptable in the heavenly courts. First, you notice that in verse 2 it says, "The Lord rebuke you, O Satan, the Lord who has chosen Jerusalem." That is so key. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem. Satan has failed to mention something that is written back in Deuteronomy chapter 7, starting in verse 6, when God says to Israel, "For you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession. Out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth, it was not because you are more in number than any other people that the Lord has set his love on you and chose you, for you are the fewest of all peoples. But it is because the Lord loves you and is keeping the oath that he swore to your fathers being Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." Satan, you have failed to mention that I have chosen Israel. And I want you to notice the deep connection here. You notice the way it says, "The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem." There's a deep connection between the people of God and God himself. It's as if when Satan starts to accuse the people of God, he's insinuating that God's character is flawed. He's slandering God's integrity. It is as if he's saying, "God, you chose this group? This is your people? This is who you chose?" Slandering his integrity, slandering his redemptive purposes. To accuse the people of God is to slander the character of God. Y'all, when it comes to our study of the doctrine of election, I'm sure we could have all kinds of debate. And if you want to learn more about that, I would suggest Dr. Young's Systematics class to you. He does it twice a year. But in this setting, let me just simply say this. As you study the doctrine of election, if at the end of your study of the doctrine of election, you have not come to the place where the accuser has been silenced, you've missed it. You need to go back and study it again. Because the doctrine of election takes my eyes off of me and places it onto God. And I realized that once God has set his love on someone, he never removes it. It is unshakable, unmovable, does not fluctuate or waver. And so as I fluctuate and waver, I know that his electing love does not. And that's why Paul in Romans 8, verse 33 says, who can bring a charge against God's elect? What charge is Satan going to throw out there against God's elect? That's the first ground. The second thing we see is at the end of verse 2, the angel of the Lord says, is not this a brand plucked from the fire? That brand meaning a log or a stick that has been plucked from a fire. This is a beautiful word picture. In a fire, you know that the fire will blaze and burn on wood until it's completely consumed. But Israel is a log that has been plucked out of the fire. Yes, they have experienced God's discipline, the heat of God's discipline, his purifying discipline in exile. But exile was not meant to destroy them. He has plucked them out of the fire. He has spared them from judgment, from wrath. And therefore, because of his infinite mercy and grace, Satan, you are out of order. Because this is a people who have been spared from divine judgment, and you have not mentioned that yet. And then finally, when it comes to our grounds for approval in the heavenly courts, what's going to become of these dirty clothes? There has to be a transfer when it comes to these dirty clothes. And verse 4 is one of the most glorious verses in all of the Old Testament. And the angel said to those who were standing before him, before Joshua, remove the filthy garments from him. And to Joshua he said, behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you, and I will clothe you with pure vestments. Notice there, the angel does what Joshua cannot do. He tells Joshua, I will take your iniquity, and I will give you pure vestments. You understand that this vision is not about clothes. This vision is about how we are acceptable to a holy God. How could he possibly accept us in our condition? The angel of the Lord has to take away the filth and give us new garments. And when it says, by the way, pure garments, this is something much higher, much greater, much more radiant, much more glorious than anything that's made by hands in Exodus chapter 28. These are garments that make Joshua fit to stand before God and know that he's totally accepted. Notice in verse 5 that Zechariah, he joins in the vision. I'm not sure if there's any other vision where the person viewing it speaks up, but here we go. He says, let them put a, Joshua speaks up, he says, let them put a turban on his head. Don't forget the turban. The high priest needs a turban. Back in Exodus chapter 28, when we give a description of the turban, had a golden plaque or plate on the forehead of the turban, and it read, holy to the Lord. Don't forget that turban, because he has gone from being utterly foul to being holy to the Lord. It is in Christ they were made holy to the Lord, set apart for his purposes as his treasured people. What this text does not tell us, it alludes to it, but it doesn't tell us, what's going to become of those filthy garments? And the wonder of wonder is that the angel of the Lord, the judge here, will step off his throne, come to earth, take on flesh, live a holy life, a perfect life. He alone can stand before the throne with perfect righteousness. And it's on the cross, as our great high priest, as our representative, he is the one who wears those filthy clothes. Those filthy clothes that belong to Joshua and all who Joshua represents, which is saints, Old Testament and New. is on the cross that Jesus wears those filthy garments and experiences the shame and the rejection that comes with being clothed in those foul garments. And he hands us his perfect, spotless righteousness. Or to say it another way, he who knew no sin became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. What are our grounds? What are our grounds for acceptance in the heavenly courts? We've been chosen by God. We have been spared from judgment. And we've been clothed in the righteousness of Christ. I believe this is a beautiful word picture, a beautiful picture of some words that we see in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. He chose us in Christ. God chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and blameless before him. Chosen before the foundation of the world. Why? To be holy and blameless before him, and that's what we see here. What's the application of all this? The application of being found acceptable in the heavenly courts. It's Thomas Brooks in his great book, Precious Remedies Against Satan's Devices. One of the remedies against Satan's devices that he recommends is that we repent of being discouraged by our sins. Repent of being discouraged by our sins. In other words, when you find yourself so weighed down by your sin that you're unable to pray, repent. Repent of the sin of thinking that the righteousness of Christ is not enough, that the cross is not enough, that somehow you've been gifted righteousness, but you've soiled it up a little bit, so maybe I need to go back and scrub it up a little bit. If you find yourself hindered by your sin, repent of that sin. Yes, when Satan points out our sin, he has so much to pick from. Yes, I bring that to God, but I don't just stay there. I also am reminded of what I have in Christ. And by the way, as Joshua is the high priest, as he has seen this and hears this, what do you think that will do for his ministry? All of a sudden, he's not consumed by, oh, am I acceptable? Am I not acceptable? To know that you're accepted in the heavenly courts, does that not give us a little bit more boldness and confidence to look away from ourselves unto Christ and others? But finally, I say this, for those who walk in this room who are outside of Christ, you have to understand that when Judgment Day comes, you will be there in filthy garments. It's the great equalizer. No matter how nice of a person you are, or how few curse words you say, or how little alcohol you consume, this is our condition. Also, the condition of those who think maybe they're way too far gone. They've done too much. Clean myself up and then come to Christ. And this vision pushes against both of that, both of those notions. If you're asked, why should you be accepted in the heavenly courts? If you're asked, why would you be accepted? If your answer involves anything other than Christ, you don't know the gospel. It's Christ, it's Christ, it's Christ, it's Christ. And his righteousness. So, oh dear child of God, as we struggle with the anxiety of picking out clothes on a day-to-day basis, would we be fully secure knowing that we are 100% totally accepted and acceptable in the eyes of our Heavenly Father because of Christ? Father, this is good news, and this is great salvation that you have given us through your Son. And we say thank you, and we also confess that we are prone to doubt. We are sinful, and we are prone to doubt, and in our pride, try to elevate our works, our accomplishments, as if they can add something to it. And so, Father, would you give us a greater faith in the righteousness of Christ? And Father, would you save those who come in this room trusting in something else besides him for your glory's sake? Amen. Three things we do as we close here at Grace of Ann. First, if you need prayer, if something's happened in your life and you would like somebody to pray with you and for you, as a pastor, that's one of our great privileges. It's not that the pastor's prayer is better. It's just as a pastor, you get to pray with people. Come find me after the service, and I would love to pray with you. Second thing is if you have completed the new members class, been interviewed by an elder, you're very close to the finish line, all you have to do is come up here as we sing, and I'll introduce you to the congregation. And finally, if you come in here outside of Christ, or just not even really understanding what we're talking about, would you please find me after the service and ask me your questions, and I will do my best to answer them? It would be my privilege. Would you stand now as we close? Lift your eyes and receive the benediction. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning. It's good to see you. Make sure on your way out you find a blue card, grab it, and fill it out, and make sure you get that turned back in. And we're back on Wednesday night, so hope to see you there.
Thanks so much for joining us. We hope that God has been at work in your heart in this time of worship, especially through the preaching of his word. If you want to know more about following Jesus or have questions about Grace of Ann, simply head to our website at graceofann.org. There you'll find ways to get in touch with our pastoral staff, along with information about all of our ministries, including Amazing Graceland, our youth ministries, young adults, college, and our adult ministries. We hope to see you in person next Sunday and invite you to come be part of our midweek worship on Wednesday at 6:30. God bless.